style. Style is the answer to everything. A fresh way to approach a dull or dangerous thing. To do a dull thing with style is preferable to doing a dangerous thing without style. To do a dangerous thing with style is what I call art. Bullfighting can be an art. Boxing can be an art. Loving can be an art. Opening a can of sardines can be an art. Not many have style. Not many can keep style. I have seen dogs with more style than men, although not many dogs have style. Cats have it with abundance. When Hemingway put his brains to the wall with a shotgun, that was style. Or sometimes people give you style. Joan of Arc had style. John the Baptist, Jesus, Socrates, Caesar, Garcia Lorca. I have met men in jail with style. I have met more men in jail with style than men out of jail. Style is a difference. A way of doing, a way of being done. Six herons standing quietly in a pool of water. Or you walking naked out of the bathroom without seeing me.
I mean, I wanted to show, I showed it to Joe and Luigi because it's something that really informs kind of my vision of the world. And it's about having a point of difference. And I think it's the kind of number one thing that I, you know, feel is critical for students and for education is to kind of capture and hone that point of difference. And style is a way of, it's a way of doing, it's a way of undoing, and it's a way of being. And I think he puts it so eloquently in this. And style often gets is very misunderstood in our culture, and people always try and ask the question, well, what's the difference between fashion and style, and he puts it, you know, in this kind of very quantum way, which is that style is literally, it's a way of seeing the world, it's a way of being, and it's a point of view, and that's the most critical thing that we can all have as artists, as creators, as designers, as writers, as anybody that's contributing to the cultural discourse, is that point of view is where it all starts and ends. And one of the key things he said is it's holding on to it. You know, that it's not just having it, it's holding on to it and developing it as you continue in the journey, and that's something we'll talk about as well, hopefully.
Keep on keeping on.
Not keep on keeping on, keeping on being relevant, you know, and it's like with Dazed and Confused, we're 20 years in the game, and it's like, it's still a relevant media for, you know, what I love about Bukowski is that he's an outsider artist, you know, and his point of view there is that I've seen more men in jail with style than out of jail. It really appeals to my sort of sense of feeling comfortable with people who are outside of the system. You know, I've always felt more comfortable with the misfits, the outsiders, the people that didn't quite fit in, those on the margins of culture. And I think Dazed and Confused began as you can say it's a reaction to the mainstream because we were reacting to the generation before us in terms of wanting to create our own media and have our own voice, but we also knew what we stood for.
Yeah.
And so it's not just a nihilistic pose like, you know, fuck the system, we're anti that. It's
bang,
not, you
boss.
Know, it's actually, but we stand for this. And that was about youth empowerment. That was about inspiration, not aspiration. That was about finding these outsider voices in culture, transdisciplinary voices from across the breadth of culture as far as we could reach in our sort of, you know, youthful imaginations at that time, and bringing it together in what was then a magazine, but was also a dialogue, was also events, was also live, was also sort of in the living of it rather than just in the printed matter.
I think that what Jefferson just said.
Sorry, am I okay talking to him like that, or should we? No, it's probably not great, right?
You might.
I'm not a natural performer, but I just figured that was wrong. You know, like instinctively, I thought, that's not working for these guys, you know? like, that's better, right?
Absolutely.
Gianluigi's done 200 interviews today. He's been running around Milan. He's been interviewing people in the back of taxis. He's been interviewing people like about Roland Barthes. He's been doing metaphysical stuff. I think he's literally on the verge of burnout. So we have to be gentle with him.
Well, I think it's what is interesting about Jefferson's attitude and is like what he did in like.
I'm not that interesting. That's not the point. I mean, I really want to sort of go against this whole sort of like self-mythologizing. I think it's really, really important for people, especially for me. I was talking to someone last night, actually, Luigi, and he was like, you know, you were really great when I first met you. Then you became an asshole, and you're a little bit more mellow now, and you're kind of a nicer guy. And what he meant was like, don't believe your own hype, you know. And that's just so important. You know, to get real. I don't consider myself an artist. I don't consider myself a designer. I consider myself at best an observer, you know, and really I've observed people and been excited by people who I feel are contributing a difference and making a difference. And then I've asked them questions. And as Hans said, you know, his education was his interview project, which is this ongoing kind of interviewing of people. And that was really my beginning, was journalism, was interviewing, was asking people the question, why are they doing what they're doing? What do they stand for? Who are their references? Researching their bibliography, and then bringing that to the reader, and then expanding from that curatorially, inviting them in to do projects and so forth. So really, I'm an observer at best, and I think it's really important that I remain humble in that respect, and we talk about actually the projects and the physicality of,
absolutely,
what's going on rather than me.
But I think that what is interesting is your attitude, which is the attitude of a learner, someone who wants to learn constantly. And it's that reflects in the magazines. I mean, in another magazine you find poetry, you regularly find poetry. In each, all the issues I remember, there's poetry. Serious poetry, like literature, high, sublime poetry. Why is this part of your independent way?
We kind of started with a poem, didn't we? You know, so no, it's not part of the independent way. What I call the independent way is this sort of balance between commerce and creativity, and I think that's we can talk about it a little bit more specifically. But the reason why we have a literature section is just because it seemed incredibly natural to have one. Dazed and Confused was a magazine, a monthly magazine. It's about speeding up. It's about putting the fast forward on culture. It's about what's next. It's about all of the kind of newness in culture. There's an element of looking back to look forward in terms of looking at cultural VIPs. But when I launched another, what was really important for me was to say, hang on a minute, there has to be a new way of storytelling, and I'm getting older, and how do I slow things down? How do I capture time? How do I represent a new frequency? And we invented the biannual market, which was to have a magazine that came out twice a year. There was maybe one other magazine that was kind of biannual at that time, but it wasn't really a market for it. And then many, many others followed. But what was great was it was a sort of William Gibson inspired me, actually, because I was talking to him about magazines, and he said, the future of magazines is the bookazine. It's the hybrid between the book and the magazine. And it was really that kind of hybrid approach to publishing that we took. And, you know, literature was a way of doing that. It's also a way of slowing down. And it was a way of putting in meaning. And it's the root of all inspiration it's the root of all inspirations, literature.
More solidity.
It's the beginning of the story, isn't it? You know, without that, there's no story.
There's no substance.
Yeah.